Hello everyone. Today we are going to perform an experiment on Pohl's pendulum to analyze the nature of free as well as forced oscillations. So all of you can see the experimental setup. So this pendulum was initially designed by the German physicist R.W. Pohl, and here this pendulum is basically it's a rotating pendulum which is subject to simple harmonic motion. It can also be called a torsional pendulum. Now see, it executes to and fro motion around a mean position. These are basically undamped oscillations, but due to some air frictions, these do not turn out to be completely undamped, and they eventually die out. But in principle, they should be undamped oscillations. Now, the free oscillations can be divided into two categories: undamped as well as damped oscillations. These oscillations are undamped oscillation, and a damping factor can be introduced through the power supply. Now we will switch on this power supply and let's set the voltage to a finite value, let's say 3 volt. The voltage has been set to approximately 3 volts, and now we will again bring this pointer to the extreme end. And one can notice that the amplitude of oscillations is lesser in this case as compared to the previous case, and these oscillations die out quickly. So what is the reason of this? An electromagnet has been set at the base of this Pohl's pendulum, and when a power supply has been introduced to this electromagnet, there is formation of magnetic field in this area, and the wheel of this Pohl's pendulum has been made of copper, which is a conducting material. So when this copper wheel makes to and fro motion in the area where the magnetic field is already there, there is formation of eddy current on this wheel, and this eddy current try to oppose the cause of it, due to which there is some kind of obstruction or damping in the motion of this Pohl's pendulum. So this damping can be made to increase by the increase of voltage here. So this was the case of damped oscillations. Earlier we had discussed about undamped oscillations where the voltage was zero. So both of them were free oscillations. Now we will move ahead to forced oscillations. Now we will switch on the power supply, increase the value of current or potential difference, and due to this current, this motor starts to rotate. And due to rotations of this motor, there is an external torque experienced by Pohl's pendulum, and the Pohl's pendulum starts to feel forced oscillations. For any particular value of frequency, we can see these forced oscillations. So we can change the frequency in this way. So at this time the current is very low, we can increase the amount of current to see difference in the values. When we increase the frequency, the oscillations become stronger to reach at the maximum amplitude at a particular frequency, which is called the resonance frequency. After that, the amplitude of these oscillations start to decrease. So these were the forced oscillations that we just discussed. Forced oscillations can also be made undamped as well as damped. The aim of our experiment consists of the study of free as well as forced oscillation. The first part is free oscillations. So what we have to do to determine the oscillating period and the characteristic frequency of the undamped case, to determine the oscillating periods and the corresponding characteristic frequencies for different damping values. Successively, unidirectional maximum amplitudes are to be plotted as a function of time. The corresponding ratios of attenuation, damping constants, and logarithmic decrements are to be calculated. The second part is forced oscillations, and what we have to study, the resonance curves are to be determined and to be represented graphically using the damping values of A. The resonance frequencies are to be determined and are to be compared with the resonance frequency values found beforehand. Now we will start from the case of free oscillations when we are not providing any power supply. So in this case the oscillation will be undamped, and now we will bring this pointer to the extreme end or the maximum amplitude, which is 20 degree, and after that we will leave it, and the pulse pendulum will start oscillating, and one by one we will observe successive amplitudes at different time periods, for example T, 2T, 3T and so on both the sides, left side as well as right side. Now see, T time period, 2T, 3T, have to note them down one by one, so we have to be quite quick as well as observant. We can also see it by pausing a video. So this is the table, amplitude versus time for free oscillations, undamped and damped. For this case, when the voltage was zero, the pulse pendulum experienced undamped oscillations, and we have observed the amplitude on the left as well as right side of the pulse wheel. So initially the maximum amplitude was 20 after one complete rotation, or after T time this is the amplitude, and then at 2T, 3T, 4T, and similarly on the right side. On the right hand side the times are the half integral multiples of the time period, T by 2, 3T by 2, 5T by 2 and so on. After that we have to take the average of the maximum amplitudes on both the sides, and then the natural log of the average amplitude. After that we have to calculate the logarithmic decrement, that is the natural log of the ratio of successive amplitudes, which is equal to natural log of K, and this K is basically the damping ratio. So after doing all the calculations, we will repeat the same procedure for 2 volt, 6 volt, 10 volts. So all of them will correspond to the case of damped oscillations, and the first case was for the undamped oscillation. Now to analyze the case of damped oscillations, we have set the voltage to 6 volts, and now again we will repeat the same procedure. We will quickly note down the readings. Now this is just a reference graph depicting the trend of log amplitude versus time taken at 10 volt. So we can observe here that there is a linearly decreasing trend of log amplitude with time. Now we will proceed further to measure the time period for the free oscillations for the undamped and damped case. Now the voltage is 0 volt, so it is the undamped case. We will bring this pointer to the extreme end and leave it like that so that the oscillations take place. We will measure the total time for 5 successive oscillations and then divide this time by 5 to find out the average time period. So we will start the stopwatch. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we should repeat the measurement for 3 to 4 times to eradicate the error possible in the situation. Now this is the table in which we have to fill the readings that we have taken. Now this was the first case that we had observed. For 5 oscillations this was the time taken. Through this we can find out the time period as well as frequency, and then the damping constant, which is the ratio of the logarithmic decrement and the time period. Logarithmic decrement we had find out in the previous table. We have to repeat these measurements for 3 to 4 times, and after that we will proceed to the case of damped oscillations for 2 volt, 6 volt and 10 volt. Now we will observe the case of damped and free oscillations by increasing the voltage. Let us say 2 volt. We'll do this for 2 volts. We'll repeat the same scenario. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So in this way we can proceed for other voltages as well. So we had just measured the characteristic frequency for the free oscillations for undamped and damped case. Now we will move ahead to the case of forced oscillations. Let us just switch on this power supply and let us just set this voltage to a sufficiently high value. Let's say 20 volt. Now the output from this power supply is going to this exciter or motor. You can see the wheel is rotating and this is providing an external torque to this Pohl's pendulum. Now due to this external torque, the oscillations of this Pohl's pendulum turn out to be forced instead of the free oscillations. And by adjusting this knob from here, we can set the course and accordingly the frequency of this motor is changed. And according to frequency, the amplitude of these oscillations is also changed. At a certain frequency, we can note down from here that the amplitude is maximum and that frequency is called the resonance frequency. Now we will increase the course from here and accordingly we can also see that the frequency of the motor is also changing here, that is reflected through the speed of these turns. We can increase the frequency and at a certain point of time when the frequency is in resonance with the characteristic frequency for the free oscillations for the undamped case, we can see the maximum amplitude on this wheel. So we are going to that position. Now we have set this motor to a particular frequency. It takes the oscillations some time to adjust to a particular amplitude. So we have waited for that time and now we have set the frequency to the resonance frequency and we can see that amplitude is very high but it is continuously increasing. Actually for the case of undamped and forced oscillations, the amplitude is actually quite high, so we cannot measure a particular value from here. So now we will proceed to the case of damped oscillations, that is at 2 volt, 6 volt and 10 volt. So this is the case for forced and damped oscillations for 2 volt. We have adjusted the frequency from here. So at a particular frequency, when this motor's frequency is in resonance with those of the free oscillations at 2 volt, the amplitude of these oscillations is maximum. So before this frequency and after this frequency, the amplitude of these oscillations is lower. So this particular case is for the resonance frequency where we have achieved the maximum amplitude. The amplitude is 11.4, we can see from here. Now we will note down this resonance frequency for the forced oscillations at 2 volt. So what we have to do, we will start measuring the time with the help of a stopwatch. Then this white marker is aligned with this pointer and we will note down the total time taken for 5 such rotations. Let us just start. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now this is the table that we have to make, frequency versus amplitude under forced oscillation. So before this we were observing the case of undamped oscillations where the voltage was 0. So there also we had varied the frequencies to achieve the resonance frequency. So at that resonance frequency we had observed the time period and we have not shown that in the video, and the amplitude at that particular resonance frequency was very high, that we also couldn't measure. Now for 2 volt that we have just seen, in this case we have measured the total time for 5 rotations of the motor, that we can fill here. We can find out the time period by dividing the total time by 5. Also the resonance frequency can be found by applying this formula, 2 pi divided by the time period, and after that this is the amplitude. If we increase the frequency further, the amplitude will start decreasing. For 6 volt, 10 volt also, we can find out the resonance frequency in the same way. Now, this is the characteristic graph, which is basically the resonance curves corresponding to different dampings. Here we can see these are the different resonance curves corresponding to different values of dampings or the voltages applied. Actually, in this particular graph, currents have been shown, but we had actually varied the potential differences, which will also correspond to the similar kind of patterns. We can see here that the graph that corresponds to the minimum value of the maximum amplitude corresponds to the highest value of potential difference, and as we decrease the potential difference, or we can say as we decrease the damping, the maximum amplitude at the resonance frequency starts increasing, and this is particularly the case for undamped oscillations, where we achieve a very large value of the maximum amplitude at the resonance frequency. Now these are our final results. These are the damping voltages, and this is the value of logarithmic decrement that we have attained at different damping voltages, damping constant. So these values we had calculated earlier. Now we have observed the resonance frequency for the undamped and damped case, and in this way we can estimate also this resonance frequencies. So in this formula there is the characteristic frequency for the free and undamped oscillations. So we have calculated this frequency earlier for the case of free oscillations, and this is the value of damping constant. So the observed and the estimated values of the resonance frequencies should be approximately same, and this is the value of the resonance amplitude achieved at the resonance frequency. So we have attained the final results. Now the precautions of the experiment: there should be no zero error in the instrument, and if due to some reason the zero error occurs, that must be corrected. There should be no parallax error while observing the value of amplitude. The time measurement should be quite precise while observing the time period of these oscillations and the motor rotation. Experiment could give the ideal results if it had been performed in the vacuum. I hope all of you have understood the experiment. Thanks for watching.